Well, let's go ahead and get right into it. If you have your Bibles, turn over to Hebrews chapter 4. Is everybody doing okay after the Ohio State game last night? Gotta pray, Saints. It's a rough season. It's a rough time. I think Saturday night, last night, they were a little bit quiet in service. And I'm not saying that they cursed Ohio State by being quiet, but I'm just saying it didn't help them at all. So I think if you're really loud and really active this morning, it's gonna help the Browns this weekend. Hebrews chapter 4, beginning in verse 12. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says this. For the word of God is alive and powerful. It's sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before his eyes. And he is the one to whom we are accountable. Let me read that again. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. For the word of God is alive and powerful. How many people are thankful that the word of God isn't stagnant? It's not dead. It's not dry. It's not stale. It's not powerful. It's alive. It's active. It's powerful. It's sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before his eyes. And he is the one to whom we are accountable. Now rewind with me to the book of Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. We're gonna pick up in the middle of a story where Adam and Eve are in the Garden of Eden. God has created this beautiful garden. He's created man and woman and he's placed them here and he says, hey, just have fun in here. Tend it, keep it, have a great time. There's just one thing you can't do. Just don't eat from this tree and you'll be set. Everything else, good. Enjoy it, hang out with the animals, eat the great fruit, enjoy each other. You're naked, you're man, you're woman, your husband, your wife. Do what you guys do. It's gonna be a great time. I have set you up for success right now. But don't eat from the tree. And what does man and woman do? The one thing that God tells them not to do. They eat from the tree, and we pick up in the middle of that story in Genesis chapter 3, verse 8. It says this, when the cool evening breezes were blowing, the man and his wife heard the Lord God walking about in the garden. So they hid from the Lord God among the trees. Then the Lord God called to the man, where are you? And man replied, I heard you walking in the garden, so I hid. I was afraid because I was naked. God says, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree whose fruit I commanded you not to eat? Man and woman are hiding because they're afraid because they're naked. And God shows up and he asks them, where are you? And who told you? I wanna talk to you for just a few minutes this morning from the subject between the trees. Between the trees. Let's go ahead and let's pray one more time together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word that's alive, that's active, that's powerful. Lord, speak to us. Thank you for the Holy Spirit that is our teacher, our leader, our guide. Teach us, lead us, guide us into your truth this morning. We thank you for your goodness, for your grace, and for your mercy. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Hebrews chapter 4 carries kind of a weighty verse in verse 13 where it says, all of us are accountable to God. And that word accountable, that's kind of a heavy word. It's kind of an intense word. It kind of means you have to give an account for. You're accountable. What you do, what I do, we're accountable to God for that. It's not like we just get away with things in our life. It's we're eventually going to be accountable to God for what we do. So I want to ask you a question this morning. In your life, how do you process and how do you handle accountability? When somebody holds you accountable to something, what's your initial reaction? How do you handle accountability? I can remember years ago in elementary school, I believe that I was in fourth grade, and I went to a Spanish immersion school. My mom and dad sent all of us kids to a Spanish immersion school, which means they just teach you Spanish all through elementary years. I don't know if my mom and dad wanted to ship us off to Mexico when we graduated or what, but we went. So puedo hablar español solamente un poquito, just a little bit. So we went to Spanish immersion school. And I remember in third grade, in the hallway that year, there was a giant mural from this famous artist that had come through the summer and painted this beautiful mural on our school wall. And it had just different kids from different parts of the world and different ethnicities and flags. And also, it was just like this just beautiful, elaborate mural. And it was like the pride of our elementary school, Milwaukee Spanish Immersion School. Back then, it was called 55th Street School. It was it. It was just epic. It was beautiful. It was awesome. It was colorful. It was wonderful. And I can remember we all had to wait out in that hallway, my class at one time, and we lined up against the mural. And we were just looking at it, and we were just, you know, appreciating it like third graders do. And, you know, we're just like, oh, this is cool, this is crazy, whatever. And my one friend, for some reason, says, I dare you to do a full-blown karate chop right into this mural. Now, it's made of, like, plywood. It's not going to break or anything. But it's like, I dare you to just run up and just hit this thing. And I'm third grade, so I have no common sense whatsoever. So I'm like, okay, like, yeah, let's do it. Me and all 15 pounds of me. So I walk back, and I go to the other side of the hallway, and I take as big of a running start as I can, and I just hurl my body into this mural. And I, again, 15, 20 pounds, I bounce off the mural, and it makes a loud noise, and we all kind of laugh about it. Nothing happens to the mural. Thankfully, nothing happened physically to me. But in the meantime, I hadn't noticed our vice principal, Mrs. Swan, was walking down the hallway. Now, Mrs. Swan, lovely lady, kind of looked like a Dr. Seuss character just a little bit. So she had this intimidating factor to us, and she had real short hair and a very intense voice, and she was white, but we went to a Spanish school, so she always yelled at us in Spanish. And she saw what happened. And this is the pride of our school. This is a mural that just got done. And this dorky little third grade kid just threw his whole body into this mural. And Mrs. Swan catches me and she yells at me. She knows who I am. Noah, venga acá. And I'm like, oh my gosh. And like in that moment, accountability has come to me face to face as a third grader. She starts yelling at me and saying things to me, probably swearing at me in Spanish, and I don't even know. And I'm just like overwhelmed by the moment. I'm overwhelmed because I'm exposed by my failure. I got caught. I got busted. I'm being held accountable. My teacher comes up. The vice principal explains to my teacher what happened. My teacher takes me back with the class to the classroom, sits me by his desk and starts to ask me questions. Why did you do that? What were you thinking? And this is what I did the whole time. I kept my head down on his desk in my arm crying. Snot pouring from my nose. I knew even if I wanted to lift my head up, I couldn't because I would be so embarrassed at the amount of liquid on my face at that moment. So for 15, 20 minutes, we sat there. And he was a nice teacher, so he eventually felt bad for me. He's like, this kid's not lifting his head up out of his, you know, really the fetal position on the desk. He's scared, he's crying. He's probably has a puddle of snot on the floor already. I was face to face with accountability. I can remember back then, and my response was to just shut down. I couldn't handle the pressure. I was exposed by my failures, and I had to give an account for my action and what I had just done. And my response, my way of getting through it was I just shut down. Nothing. Couldn't say a word, completely broken and embarrassed. I can think about the process that we're going through with my daughter right now. She's 6 years old. And a few years ago, probably about 2, 3, 4 years old, when she would do things that she wasn't supposed to do, she always had a go-to. Paige, don't touch that. That's not for playing with. And she'd play with it, knock it over. Paige, you're not supposed to do that. Or she'd get sassy or say, Paige, we don't talk like that. Don't talk back. You don't say that. And her go-to was always this. Oh, Daddy, I didn't mean to do it. Paige, no, hey, what did I say? Nope, go over there. Stop. You better start listening. Oh, Daddy, I didn't mean to do it. And we had to explain to her in that season of life, no, you meant to do it. You just got busted for doing it, and you have to give an account for it, and you're not sure how to handle it. You're not sure how to process it. Well, a couple years has gone by. She's 6 years old, thinking that she's 16. And she's got a lot of personality. and a lot of sass and attitude. I don't know where she gets it from. So now her thing is, when confronted with one of her failures, or if she makes a mistake or does something she knows she's not supposed to do, it's, hey, Paige, if you do that again, I'm taking that away from you. And her go-to is no longer, oh, daddy, I didn't mean to. Now it's, I don't care. Hey, Paige, if you do that again, you're gonna go take a time out. I don't care. Paige, hey, I already told you once, you're gonna get a spanking now. Did you disobey what we talked about already? Are you wrong for what you did right now? Yes. Should you get a spanking? Yes. Well, you're gonna get one. I don't care. I can remember a couple weeks ago, this just happened. We were out to eat at a restaurant and she was having a moment, and she's actually a great kid, but she has her moments like all kids have their moments. And she's having a moment where she's being a little bit sassy, talking back a little bit, and my wife is sitting across the table from her and looks at her and says, Pace, we need to go to the bathroom and have a talk. And every parent knows what we need to go to the bathroom and have a talk means. So she goes, we're gonna go to the bathroom and have a talk, because I already told you to change your attitude. And Paige looks at her, and Steph goes, or you can change your attitude right now. What do you wanna do? And Paige looks at her and goes, let's go to the bathroom and have a talk. God's honest truth. So we're working through this with our daughter. The accountability, your actions, my actions, what we do in life, we are accountable for. And Hebrews chapter 4 says that all of us in this room, nobody is exempt. Everybody on the planet is accountable to God. You and I have to give an account for what it is that we've done. And in our lives, when we fail, when we make mistakes, when we go against God's word, when we go against what he's told us to do or what we know we should be doing and we do the opposite, there has to be an accountability that's given. There's a moment that we're exposed by our failures. And when we have to give accountability, the question is, how do we handle it? How do you and how do I process accountability? What does our accountability look like when it comes to God? When we know we've messed up and we've failed, when we know, hey, whether you're newly saved, not saved, or been saved for a long time, and you're still making mistakes, when you know in those moments you're having to be accountable to God, you're trying to figure out, I'm trying to figure out and navigate through, what's the process of my accountability? How do I feel now that I've been exposed by my failure? And we pick up in Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve are dealing with that. They've been exposed by their failure. They're naked and they're afraid right now. And their failure has gotten them to a point where they're naked and they're uncertain and they're hiding behind a tree and they're hiding from God. Because they don't know at this moment, because of my mistakes and my failures and my disobedience, I'm not sure in this moment where us and God are. I don't know where I stand with God right now. So they hear him coming. So instead of going out and talking and saying, this is what happened, what do? They run and they hide, because when you're exposed by your failures, you can easily become uncertain with where you stand with God. God, I know I wasn't supposed to do this. God, I know I made these mistakes. I've done the same thing a million times. God, I know I read in your word. I heard at church, or I just know you told me not to do it anymore, but I did it anyways, and I made that mistake. And all of a sudden, we find ourselves hiding because we're uncertain at this moment where we stand with God. I'm accountable for my actions. How am I going to handle the accountability with God? Where do I stand with God? Because an authentic relationship with God, an authentic, real, genuine, not a religious, not a church experience, a day-to-day, intimate, real relationship with God, an authentic relationship with God requires an accurate understanding of how he sees you. If you're gonna have an authentic, real Sunday through Sunday, Monday through Monday, Tuesday through Tuesday, if you're gonna have a real authentic relationship with God, you're gonna have to know, and I'm gonna have to know, we're gonna make mistakes in this life. And in those moments, what is our position with God? To have an authentic relationship, I have to have an accurate, you have to have an accurate understanding of how God sees me at this moment. Where do I stand with God when I'm being a bad husband? And I know it. Where do I stand with God when I'm being a poor parent and I know it? Where do I stand with God when I'm being greedy or I'm lying or I'm caught up in pornography or an affair or I'm caught up in gossiping and backbiting or I'm caught up with letting my mind and my heart go places that it shouldn't go? Where do I stand with God in these moments? Because I'm accountable for what's happening, but I'm just not sure where am I at with Him. And if I don't have an accurate understanding of it, the authenticity of my relationship can easily become frayed. It can easily become distant. It can easily become religious, and I only do the God thing when it's convenient. I only do the God thing when my life is living up to what I think God wants. All the other times that I'm messing up, God doesn't want to have anything to do with me. I don't want to have anything to do with God. I'm not sure about where He's at. I'm just going to do my thing over here. So God is a clock-in moment. I'm doing pretty good now, God. Hey, we're together. We're boys. Got it. Bought my wife some flowers. Got to be proud of me. But then the other times when we're making mistakes and we're failing, we're just not sure where we're at with God. So I'm just going to do my thing over here. Because I don't really know where we're at right now. Adam and Eve are right now being challenged with this idea, held to an accountability and being exposed by their failures. And that's one of the challenges of Christianity, is how do I handle my sins when they expose me? God loved me so much, He saved me. We believe He died for sinners and those far from Him. And yes, amen, we preach that, we believe it. But now that I've already accepted the grace and now that I've already got the forgiveness and now that I know better and I still make mistakes, now what happens, God? Now where am I at, God? What's our standing and what's our positioning now, God? And I know You forgive me of that stuff, but there's that one thing in the past that keeps creeping up and I'm just not sure I can let that go. And man, I don't think You can forgive that. I'm just not sure if that's affecting where we're at. I know it was my fault and I know that I did it and I'm trying to figure out how to be accountable for it, but I don't know where I am now. Where do I stand with You right now? And exposure, when we're exposed by our sins, when we're exposed by our mistakes and our failures, exposure easily puts us on edge. We become uncomfortable. When you're exposed and you're in unfamiliar situations or when your failures are facing you and you realize that the God of all creation is looking and He sees everything, the good, the bad, the ugly. When we're exposed, we can easily become on edge. We as humans don't like feeling vulnerable. We don't like feeling exposed. We are on edge. I can remember years ago when I was going to school in Oklahoma, I lived in an apartment with two other guys. One of those guys being our generational pastor, my best friend, Jordan Smucker. Another guy, his name is Rob. He's from England. And three guys living together, we were pulling pranks on each other all the time. All the time, crazy stuff was happening. I'm surprised that place didn't get burnt down. One of the constant pranks that got played on was when somebody else was in the shower, it was commonplace for while you're taking the shower in the morning, somebody else has put a bucket of ice water in the refrigerator all night long. And when you're in the shower, there's a good chance that there's a bucket of ice or ice cold water coming over the top of the shower curtain, pouring down on you. Now look, I don't know about you, but I don't wake up happy in the morning. I don't wake up. I have some friends, man. I know they wake up with a smile on their face, ready to go. I wake up just kind of a little bit just annoyed. I need a moment. Probably about an hour and a half, actually. So you can imagine, back then, you're waking up in the morning, you're going to take a nice warm shower, you're kind of half asleep, half awake, trying to wake up, and all of a sudden, in the middle of that, a bucket of ice cold water gets poured on you in the shower. Every bad word you could possibly want to say, filters through your mind and hopefully not out of your mouth. So this was common. This happened all the time. All the time. And there were mornings that were even more frustrating than the buckets of ice water, is that there were times you'd be in the shower and you're in the corner of the bathtub hoping that the shower kind of protects you, and you're just waiting for it. And all of a sudden you hear somebody come in and you're like, oh no, here it comes. And all of a sudden a bucket comes over, but it's empty. Just to get you going. And here's the thing, you can't do anything about it. You're not taking a shower with a parka. You're naked in the shower, exposed. So when you are doing that and experiencing that over and over and over again, that exposure puts you on edge and you're a little uncertain. And eventually what happens is exposure, when you feel uncomfortable, when you're not sure how to process being exposed, you not only get put on edge, but exposure eventually can cause evasion. And there were mornings that I would wake up and I'd go to the bathroom half tired, and I'd go to the shower and I'd open the shower curtain and I'd look at it, and I'd look back where my roommates are at. It's just not worth it. I'm just not doing it today. And there'd be mornings where I'm just like, I'm just not gonna take a shower. I'm avoiding and evading the shower because I hate being exposed, uncertain of what's gonna come over the shower curtain at me. And exposure, when we're exposed by our failures, when you're not as good as you think you are, when you realize, man, I am making some major mistakes. Man, I'm not doing what I'm supposed to be doing. You're exposed and you're on edge because you're not sure how to process that. And that's where Adam and Eve are. They're exposed, and because they're exposed by their failures, they're avoiding, trying to evade God. It's put them in a place that they're trying to keep separation between them and between God. And if we don't begin to properly understand the accountability that we have to God and how God sees us all the time, sin in our lives can begin to cause a separation. And we can begin to feel like God is fed up, God has lost his patience, God is no longer forgiving, God is frustrated with us, God's probably shocked that I've done this, and we kind of retreat back to an area where we try to create distance and avoid God. And the enemy begins to win when he can allow sin, our mistakes, our failures, to cause a separation between us and God. But let's just take a look in closing here at what God's response is to Adam and Eve at this moment. Because what God responds to with them back then in Genesis chapter 3, I think is the same way God responds to us right now in 2015. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 8, when the cool evening breezes were blowing, the man and his wife heard the Lord God walking about in the garden. Adam and Eve have already made a mistake. They've already done the one thing they're not supposed to do. They've already been exposed by their failures. And God knows this. God is up in heaven. He saw what happened. But what is the thing? The first thing that God does is God shows right back up into the garden. That God didn't see what happened from heaven and say, humans, mankind, one thing. I told them one thing. They couldn't do one thing. Don't eat from the tree. You couldn't do that. I'm staying up here. They're done. They're on their own. No. God never, listen to me, God never leaves you on your own. God has always, Genesis chapter 3, God steps right back out of heaven like he's done all the previous days and come right back into the garden. God never leaves us on our own. God takes the first step towards man and towards woman. In the midst of their failure, in the midst of their exposure, in the midst of their fear, in the midst of their sin, in the midst of their uncertainty, God isn't over here saying, well, I'm just gonna wait for you to come out of that tree and come back and just grovel and talk about how bad you are and talk about how bad you messed up. No. God takes the first step, and God has been taking the first step towards man ever since. So you might be in here thinking the sin is too big, the sin has been done too many times, the failure has been too epic, there's been so many times that I've been asking for forgiveness. Surely God isn't still walking towards me. No. God has always taken the first step. God will always take the first step. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Second thing that God does, after God shows up, he asks them a question. Adam says, I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid, wasn't sure what's going on. And God says, who told you that you were naked? Did you eat from the tree that I told you not to? Who told you that? God is gonna seek the source of your shame. God is gonna seek the source of why we feel like we need to stay separated and hidden from God. Why we feel like because we're exposed, God is gonna feel embarrassed or disgusted by us. Who told you that? Who told you because you went through with the abortion that I didn't love you anymore? Who told you because the divorce happened that I've turned my back on you? Who told you because you can't seem to break this pornography addiction that I don't wanna have anything to do with you? Who told you that? What's the source that you're getting that from? Let me ask you a question in one sense. I feel like he's saying, are you allowing your sin to determine your status with me? Who told you that? Because I didn't tell you that. I didn't say, Adam, Eve, here I come. You better hide. I know what you did. Everything is exposed before me. I'm not taken by surprise, and I saw it. So you better go hide behind that tree that I just thought into existence. Go hide. No. Who told you to feel that way? Who told you that grace has run out? Who told you there's no more mercy for that area? Who told you that God's forgiveness isn't strong enough? Who told you to feel that way? What, because you made the mistake? Did you eat the tree that I told you not to? Man, you screwed up. You're accountable for that. You messed up. You shouldn't have done it. But who told you that you should be afraid? Who told you that you should hide? Who told you that I didn't love you anymore? He shows up and then he questions the source of their shame. And then the third thing is he sees man and woman exposing their shame, afraid. And he sees that they've made this covering to try to cover their shame. And the Bible says they made it out of fig leaves. So they said, oh man, we messed up, we're exposed, our mistake, we're accountable for what we've done, here I am, God's gonna see. So they go and they start picking leaves off of a tree. And they try to cover themselves up. And the fig leaves are just man's feeble attempt at trying to make ourselves look good before other people and look good before God. Let me just grab a couple good things here, and if I could just say a couple right things here, and if I just attend church enough, maybe that's good enough for God to love me some more. And we began to pick, just back then in Genesis, these leaves, and we've been doing it ever since to try to cover up our mistakes and cover up our failures to make ourselves look presentable to God. God shows up and he says, you got fig leaves on you? Why? What's going on? They're covered in fig leaves. But here's the thing. The moment that you take a leaf off of its vine, the moment that you remove a leaf from the life source, that thing begins at that moment to die. And it's a matter of time before you need to go right back to the tree, right back to something else, and you're trying to find other things to cover yourself up with, saying, I'm still not good enough. I haven't gotten it all together. Give me some more things. You think you're okay for a little bit. You walk, and all of a sudden, your covering begins to die again. And you gotta go back and say, maybe if I do this, maybe if I do that, if I try and make myself look presentable this way, and if I only talk about the right things, and I don't let anybody into my failures, and I'm just gonna take this part of my life and leave it back here so God doesn't have to address it. He's probably embarrassed by it. So I'm gonna take some more leaves and I'm gonna walk out, and eventually those things begin to die in this vicious cycle of willpower and man-made efforts to try to cover our failures begins to take place over and over and over again. But do you remember the verse when Jesus says, listen to me, I am the vine. You have to remain in me and I in you, and you can do nothing without me. You could have some temporary coverings and you can make yourself feel better for a couple weeks and you can think your good works have made you accepted and approved by God, but eventually those good works fail. Eventually they run out. Eventually you find yourself exposed by your failures again. And God looks at this and he says, fig leaves, fig leaves. And Adam says, oh, I was afraid though. I was afraid because I was naked. And the Hebrew actually says, I was afraid because naked I am. Because Adam knows, even though I have fig leaves on right now, God, I'm still exposed. Even though I tried to cover up my failure, even though I tried to cover up my inadequacies, my misgivings, my misfortunes, even though I've tried to cover up the things that I've intentionally done wrong, I know I'm not really covered before you. I know I'm still exposed, naked. Naked I am. It's present tense. Because Adam knows. And we know. At the end of the day, when we're in our car by ourselves, we're in the cubicle at work, we lay our head on our pillow at night, we know those things in life that we try to cover up, God still sees them. Everything is exposed before God. So God sees Adam and he sees what he's going through and he sees the fig leaves on him and Eve and he thinks, it's not gonna work. Those things are already dying. Those things aren't gonna do anything for you. It's a matter of time. So Genesis chapter 3 verse 21 says, and the Lord God made clothing from animal skins for Adam and his wife. It doesn't say what animal. So I'm just gonna take some liberties for just a moment. I think Adam is exposed, Eve is exposed, the fig leaves are already dying, they're trying to cover their mistakes. God sees and says, it's not gonna do, it's not gonna last. I'm gonna need to intervene, I need to do something. And he begins to look around the garden and he sees a lamb. And he says, okay, just wait right there a second. And God goes over and he does what he has to do, and he has to break the body of the lamb, and he has to go ahead and do what only he can do, because he knows that the covering for man and woman's mistake is gonna cost something. He knows the fig leaves aren't gonna last. I need something that's gonna last. So he goes and he finds a lamb and he breaks the body of the lamb, and then he goes to man and woman and he covers them with animal skin. And God had to break the body of the lamb in Genesis to cover man and woman's failures, and the body of the lamb was broken back then and he had to cover the failures. And Jesus says to his disciples, this is my body which is broken for you. And that's the power. And that's the beauty of the gospel. Is that at our worst, God gives us his best. That at the darkest times, at the most challenging times, at the most depressing moments where we feel like we should hide and be embarrassed and keep our head on that desk, where we should just go ahead and push the blame off on somebody else, where we should just go ahead and cause a separation, at the worst moments in our life, either when you just got saved, before you even are saved, or you've been saved for 50 years, even at your worst, God has still given and continues to give his best. So there they are. They're exposed. Try to cover their failures. God says, that's not gonna work. I have to do something. So he breaks the body of the animal and covers. So we see throughout the Old Testament over and over and over again for man and woman's failures, these animals are being sacrificed, repeating what happened in Genesis to make an atonement, to pay the price, to be accountable for their sin. So over and over and over again, we can trace back in the Old Testament, Adam is exposed naked behind a tree. He's embarrassed and God says, I gotta do something about it. So the body of an animal has to be broken again. Blood has to be shed again and Adam is exposed naked behind a tree, and Eve is naked behind a tree, embarrassed, ashamed, uncertain of their relationship with God, and mankind is exposed naked behind a tree, and God says, I have to do something. And here is the gospel. I have to do something. Man is hidden naked behind a tree, so I need to put my son naked on a tree for everybody to be able to see. So you can look back and say, oh my gosh, thousands of years ago when man first messed up, when we're tempted to go back to the garden and say, I need to cover myself. I need to be embarrassed. I need to cause a separation. I'm exposed. God says, no, you don't. I already broke the body of Jesus Christ and I exposed him and I put him on a tree. I put him on the tree for everybody to be able to look at and say, you didn't deserve that. Your body was broken for me. Your blood covers me. In the moments where I'm supposed to be accountable to God, and I've failed, and I've made mistakes, and you've messed up, we can be tempted to try to retreat behind the tree again. But God says, if you want to go behind the tree, fine, but you still don't really understand the gospel. You still don't really understand my plan. You still really don't understand what Jesus did and what Jesus said when he said, my body is broken for you, and when he hung on that tree. If you want to go behind the tree, fine, go ahead and do it. But the truth of the matter is, Hebrews says there was a once and for all sacrifice that was made for sin. There was a once and for all moment. So what's my accountability to God then, Noah? What are you saying? Okay, Hebrews chapter 4 says that I'm accountable to God, and what is it that I'm supposed to do? And I've made the mistakes, I've made the failures. I mean, I gotta owe up, I gotta pay up, I gotta do something, right? It says in verse 13 that I'm accountable, yeah, but reading verse 14, it says, so what? So now that we understand we're accountable to God, we understand we have a great high priest who's entered into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God. And let us hold firmly to what we believe, that this high priest of ours understands our weaknesses. For he faced all of the same testings we do, yet did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive mercy and will find grace to help us when we need it most. So I'm accountable, God. I messed up. I failed. I'm not proud of it. I'm embarrassed by it. So I have an option. I can hide behind a tree. I can try and grab some leaves and say, here's some good things that I've done to kind of avoid it. Or I can simply say, you said I'm accountable to you, but when I need help, and God, I need some help right now to come boldly to the throne of grace so that I can receive mercy. What is mercy? Mercy is a covering. You don't need mercy if you didn't do anything wrong. So God, here I am exposed. I need mercy. God, I need my accountability is I'm showing up and I'm saying, I need mercy. And it says, come to the throne of grace. Don't hide behind the tree. Come to the throne of grace and you'll receive mercy and find grace to help when you need it most. You might be sitting in here this morning and think, that's too good to be true. I have to pay up. Accountability comes with a price. I gotta do something to make up for it. There's gotta be something I can work for. There's gotta be something that I can do to just prove to God, to just show God, to just earn God's love back. There isn't. And it does sound too good to be true. But the thing is, that's the beauty of the gospel.
is that I'm not gonna live my life afraid. I'm not gonna live my life in fear. I'm not gonna live my life embarrassed by my failures, condemned by what I've done in the moments where I need it most. And the small failures or the big ones, I can look to the cross because we're caught between the trees. And we're saying, do I go back to Adam's position? Do I go back and hide? Or do I go to the one place that I can find true help and true love and true restoration and true forgiveness and true mercy and true grace? You and I are between the trees. Where are you gonna go? You gotta give accountability for what you've done. I gotta be accountable for what I've done. But here's my perspective. To have an authentic relationship with Jesus, to have an authentic relationship with God, the accurate understanding of how he sees me and how he sees you is through the cross. That he says, yeah, you're gonna make mistakes. Yeah, you've got some stuff going on. But you don't need to be hidden. You don't need to be embarrassed. I'm still right here for you. I'm still right here loving you. I'm still right here to empower you, to forgive you, to equip you, to bring you out of that thing, to cover you. That's the gospel. And that's the message that we preach, not only to one another, but to a broken world. I'm gonna ask everybody for just a moment to stand on our feet. We're gonna close. We're just gonna sing this out together. I'm gonna ask you to just close your eyes for just a moment. I want you to search your heart and where you are with God. Where are you with your accountability? Have you been trying to cover up with fig leaves? Have you allowed your mistakes, your failures to cause some form of separation? Is there maybe certain things in your life you're just not letting God address? You don't wanna bring them to God because you're just embarrassed by them? You're just feeling like there can't be any more grace, there can't be any more love, there can't be any more patience or forgiveness in this area. Is there anything that you're still hiding behind the tree? Is there something in your past that just keeps creeping up over and over and over and over again that you just can't seem to shake, and that thing keeps pulling you back to a place where you feel like you should hide, like you feel like you can't move forward, like you just can't get over it, like it's just sucking the life out of you? Is there something that's trying to pull you back to that tree? Because the good news is, for everybody, at every point, in every season, God took care once and for all of every mistake, of every failure, past, present, and future, through the cross and the blood of Jesus Christ. And that's where our hope is. And that's where our hope rests. And that's what we cling to. And that's when we're exposed by our failures and we know we've messed up and we know we've made mistakes. We don't retreat behind this tree. We go to the one tree that the Son of God was hung and crucified on, and his blood was shed so that you and I can experience life and life more abundantly, not hidden behind a tree, but we look at the man who is exposed on a tree for our faults and our failures and our sins and everything that we've gone through. That's the gospel. That's the message for you. Right now, where you stand in this moment, that's the message God has for you. You're accountable before me. But here's the thing, I've already provided the payment for every failure that you have gone through or will go through in life. So stay exposed before me because nothing is hidden. And let me empower you with my grace and cover you with my mercy. Do not separate. Instead, draw near. So Father, this morning, we look to you. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for what Jesus has done. We thank you for the price that he paid. And Father, every failure, every mistake, every bit of frustration or embarrassment or depression, every bit of bitterness and unforgiveness, everything that's keeping us hidden behind this tree, this morning we lay it at the foot of the cross, Father. We lay it at the tree that matters most. We lay it here and we say, God, take it all. I'm accountable before you. I did it. I've done it. I'm even doing it. But this morning, everything changes. God, nothing is hidden from you. I'm exposed before you. And God, I receive your mercy. I receive your grace. I receive your forgiveness because you're a God that empowers. You're a God that thrives in the impossible. You're a God of the supernatural. You're the God that provides. You're the God that heals. You are the God that restores. You're the God that forgives. You're the God that loves. You're the God that rescues. You're the God that brings us through. You're the God that declares peace and goodness and love and mercy and victory and triumph over our lives every day of our lives. You are that God, the God that is above everything, the God that is above every failure, the God that is above every sin. Your blood is stronger. Your blood is purer. Your blood is more holy than anything.